Hello, my name is Joanne Starks, and I want to welcome you to today's session, Recent Campbell Collaboration Disability Research Synthesis Results, a webcast from the Center on Knowledge Translation for Disability and Rehabilitation Research, or KTDRR, which is housed in the Austin, Texas office of American Institutes for Research. The Center on KTDRR is supported through funding from NIDLR, the National Institute on Disability, Independent Living, and Rehabilitation Research, which is a center within the Administration for Community Living in the Department of Health and Human Services. I want to thank my AIR colleague, Shoshana Rabinowski, who is helping with the technical aspects. Closed captioning is available today as part of the YouTube video. And at the end of the presentation, I will ask you to provide your feedback through a brief evaluation form. The Campbell Collaboration is an international organization that promotes positive change through the production and use of systematic reviews and other evidence synthesis for evidence-based policy and practice. The Center on KTDRR partners with Campbell, and particularly with the Disability Coordinating Group, to help increase the number of Campbell reviews in the disability field. You can find the Campbell website at campbellcollaboration.org. The previous Campbell Collaboration Library has been transferred to the journal Campbell Systematic Reviews, published by Wiley. There are many resources available on the Campbell website for researchers and for others. The backbone of Campbell is the coordinating groups, which are responsible for the production, scientific merit, and usefulness of Campbell publications. They provide editorial services and support to authors and build links with users. Since it was established in May of 2017, the Disability Coordinating Group, or DCG, has been working to achieve several objectives: to undertake and maintain a series of high quality and timely systematic reviews of interventions aimed at improving the quality of life and outcomes for individuals with disabilities. Next, to establish and maintain a network of individuals with disability systematic reviews, including as peer reviewers. Third, to encourage the involvement of people with disabilities, their family members, and other disability-oriented stakeholders in all steps of the systematic review process, including the development and dissemination of appropriate user-friendly interpretations of review results. And finally, to provide training opportunities for interested systematic review authors in the production of Campbell reviews in the disability area. Before we start the presentations, I want to point out that Campbell is sponsoring the 2021 What Works Global Summit in a virtual format. Today, a panel of DCG review authors will share their experiences with the production process and will showcase a variety of synthesis products, including traditional systematic reviews, mixed method reviews, and an evidence and gap map. These presentations were originally recorded as part of the 2020 What Works Global Summit, sponsored by the Campbell Collaboration. We'll start with individualized funding interventions to improve health and social care outcomes for people with a disability, a mixed method systematic review. Lead author and today's presenter is Pádraic Fleming, who is with the Center for Health Policy and Management at Trinity College Dublin. The next systematic review and meta-analysis examines the impact of multifaceted interventions on community participation outcomes for adults with disabilities and aims to find effective components of the interventions. The lead author and presenter is Judith Gross from the Indiana Institute on Disability and Community, Indiana University, Bloomington. The next systematic review examines the effects of interventions for reducing anxiety in school-aged children with autism spectrum disorder compared to treatment as usual. The presenters, Dr. Petra Lietz and Dr. Katherine Dix, are members of the author team from the Australian Council for Educational Research. Ending today will be an evidence and gap map showing the available evidence from systematic reviews and impact evaluations of interventions to improve the welfare of people with disabilities and their families in low and middle income countries. Lead author and presenter is Dr. Ashrita, Saran, Director of Campbell South Asia. Okay, let's get started. So Pádraic, are you ready to take it away?
Well, good afternoon, everybody, or good morning, as the case may be. I, first of all, just wanted to say thank you to the co-chairs for inviting me today to present at this session, and also to acknowledge the funders of the Systematic Review, which were the Health Research Board here in Ireland and Genio as well. So why did we undertake the Systematic Review? Primarily, it was part of my PhD. One of the main things that I was looking at my PhD was assessing the acceptability and feasibility of individualized funding within the Irish context. And at the same time, the Irish government were actively considering a policy shift towards individualized funding on a national basis. And other jurisdictions in the past have been criticized for not using international evidence before embarking on such a national rollout. To help ensure that didn't happen in Ireland, we wanted to pull together all of the international evidence and present it in one place. There had been no systematic review done on this topic previously. There had been a rapid evidence review and also a second review that focused only on mental health and not other forms of disability. So that was the rationale for embarking on this. And I guess I was asked to reflect initially on, to reflect on the process of conducting the systematic review. So I have multiple little timers here because there was parallel timings happening. So there was my PhD, which was from 2013 to 2017. And so that was a good timeline to make sure that the systematic review was pushed along. But also the Campbell Collaboration timeline also kept me honest and kept the team honest, ensuring that we were meeting various milestones. So you can see here the timeline from when we were invited to submit a title registration in September 2014, and that followed some informal communications between myself and the point of contact. And then we submitted the title registration in 2014. And I have to say, immediately we got really constructive feedback, which really did lead to clarity of thought around what it was that we were hoping to achieve and what was achievable. The title registration was published in January 2015. And then by May 2015, we submitted the protocol. The protocol development was probably one of the biggest pieces of work around this. It was a huge amount of work, but what it did do was provide a roadmap for the entire project. It really helped the team define what we meant by different terminology and to refine those definitions so that it was actually a manageable task to conduct the systematic review. And it actually helped us think through what it was that we hoped to achieve at a very early stage and to nail that down with the protocol. So we received extremely detailed feedback from five reviewers, and that led to 100 responses, which at the time seemed like a huge undertaking, but actually it was really beneficial because, as I said, it left very little to chance, and almost every eventuality was considered before we even started out on conducting the actual review. And ultimately it led to a very comprehensive reference document. So when we were in the midst of reviewing and screening articles, we sometimes could, almost forget what it was that we were trying to achieve. So we had this reference document to be able to go back to, which was fantastic. One of the things at the protocol stage that was highlighted from three of the five reviewers were concerns around the mixed methods approach, particularly the qualitative aspect. There were concerns that we were being overly ambitious and that we wouldn't be able to achieve both the quantitative and qualitative systematic reviews within the time constraints of the PhD four-year period. So we took that on board, but after very careful consideration, we offered some counter arguments as to why we felt it was very important to include the qualitative, because we did have a sense of what was available in the literature, And because we were particularly interested in the implementation of individualized funding in Ireland, which was our interest, we really wanted to see what had worked well and what were the challenges in other countries. So the full review then was submitted in September 2017, just before I submitted my PhD thesis. So that worked out very well. And it gave me a chance to have a breather while we awaited the reviewer comments. And you can see there was a bit of a delay there. And I think that was down to the fact that it was difficult to find reviewers. But ultimately, the review got published in 2019. And one of the things I wanted to just flag and to offer some appreciation was for the fact that there was continuity in terms of the point of contact. So a big thank you to Carlton Fong, who was the first person who emailed me back during the title registration. And Carlton was there all along the way, responding to any queries we might have had, right through to the very end. So big thanks to Carlton. So jumping into the actual review then. So individualized funding, what is meant by individualized funding? It's an umbrella term for many different terms that are used within the literature. But ultimately, by the end of my PhD, I started talking about the four W's. So individualized funding is a funding and support mechanism that is intended to offer choice, control, autonomy, self-determination around these four W's. So what it is that people want in their supports, is it for personal care or is it for more recreational activities or is it a bit of both? Is it, you know, to meet both of those needs? The where is in terms of where does that support take place? Is it within the person's home or is it in a professional setting? When does it take place? Is it, you know, any time of the day or is it between 9 to 5 when paid supports are available or is it after hours? And then who provides that support? Is it a network of informal supports, family and friends, or is it paid professional supports? In reality, it's a combination of all of these things. And the idea is that people are able to choose what best meets their needs and the best meets their life. And there are different methods. There's more autonomous methods of individualized funding, such as direct payments, and then supported methods such as brokered support models. That's a very quick overview, but ultimately the systematic review wants to look at two things, two key objectives, was to see, well, does individualized funding, is it effective at improving the health and social care outcomes for people with a disability when compared to a control group who are in receipt of traditional services? And then secondly, to look at the qualitative evidence and to synthesize the successes and challenges around implementation and specifically initial implementation. So this slide, I just wanted to demonstrate all of the different types of terminology that are used to describe individualized funding, and the different colors indicate different jurisdictions. So I'm sure some of you will recognize some of the terms that are there. What this meant was that actually the search strategy was very broad, and it was intentionally very broad because we wanted to ensure that we didn't miss any of these terminologies that perhaps we weren't aware of or familiar with. So the time frame was from 1985 onwards, because it was during the mid-80s that the initial demonstration projects were starting, mainly in the US and in Australia as well. The key terms were based around the population and the intervention, but nothing else at that point, again, because we didn't want to limit ourselves. We used database thesauri to explode the terms. So this is just an example from the sociological abstracts and the various different subject headings that we used. And then we also included free text terms from known terminology from the literature within the search strategy. So one of the things that I wanted to point out was that because we had this intentionally broad research strategy, it ended up being a very time-consuming process. And while we had anticipated that some of the processes will be very time consuming, such as the screening and reviewing of the studies, and then in terms of quality assessments and then data extraction analysis. We always assumed that that was going to be quite time consuming, but the search strategy itself resulted in a huge amount of results. So you can see we had 105,329 initially, and of those 95,000, almost 96,000 were imported into EndNote, and then a further almost 10,000 grey literature titles. So that seemed quite overwhelming at the time. So what we had to do was come up with what we called a results refinement process, which you can just see in the right-hand box there. And I previously actually presented at the Campbell Collaboration Global Summit in 2016. I presented that refinement process, and we wrote up a supplementary paper that outlines in detail what that looks like, and that's available as part of the systematic review online. But ultimately, we use automatic text mining to extract irrelevant terms and any articles that potentially were completely irrelevant. For example, because we were putting in brokerage, we got an awful lot of articles that were relating to the stock markets and these sorts of things. So we were very easily able to pull them out and just put them into another file. And then we had this fail-safe check of all those that we had removed and put into another file. We were able to go back and double check to see, well, have we inadvertently added any in there? And then finally, we did a manual title screen of those. So through that process, we were able to remove over 75,000 titles, which got it down to a much more manageable 7,151 titles for abstract title and abstract review. So we had double screening of the title and abstracts, and then double screening again of the 328 full text articles that were included. Ultimately, there were 215 studies that were excluded, and we were left with 73 unique studies. So 7 of those studies had quantitative data, and 69 had qualitative. There were 3 mixed methods that had both quantitative and qualitative. So I'm going to very quickly run through some of the results. You can see there from the map that we had studies from Canada, the USA, various different European countries, Australia, and New Zealand. So there were almost 40 measures reported across the 7 studies in the primary and secondary outcomes that we had listed of interest in the protocol. As I mentioned, the different countries that they came from, and they were all English language studies. And almost 60% had a sample size of over 1,000. The results were mainly positive for those in receipt of individualized funding, and I'll just quickly run through what that looked like. So in terms of our primary outcomes of quality of life, 4 of the 7 studies reported quality of life, and 2 of these studies were showed positive results for those in receipt of individualized funding, while 2 showed no difference between the intervention group and the control group. In terms of client satisfaction, there were 12 different measures used across the 5 studies that looked at client satisfaction, and almost all of these were positive for those in receipt of individualized funding, whereas there was no difference for 1 of the measures used in 1 of the studies. So we looked at some secondary outcomes. One of those was physical functioning. Only 1 study reported this, and there was no difference found between the intervention and control group. And we also looked at adverse impacts, and there was different types of adverse impacts that we were looking at. 5 studies looked at these, and there was mixed findings across the sites and across the measures, but again, mainly positive. There was 1 study that indicated that the intervention group were more likely to have unmet needs. Probably the main factor that came out as negative was around cost effectiveness. So 3 studies reported this. 1 study actually had insufficient data to include. So of the 2 that were included, 1 showed mixed results, so either negative or no difference in the different measures that were used, and then 1 showed no difference. And then finally, we looked at other measures such as safety and security and community participation. And 4 studies resulted other measures, 1 positive and 3 showed no difference. So I apologize for flying through that. The detail is all in the systematic review, but I wanted to just give you a sense of the type of data that we were finding. So in terms of the qualitative studies, then there were 69 studies ranging from the early 90s up to 2016. These came from a lot more countries than the quantitative data came from. And I guess unsurprisingly, the sample sizes were smaller. And we did include 1 non-English study, which was Dutch. So again, very quickly to just give an overview of the findings, we split them into implementation facilitators and implementation challenges. And then the perspectives of staff and organizational representatives. So in terms of perceived benefits, there were very many perceived benefits expressed within the literature, particularly from individuals with a disability or their representatives, less so sometimes from professionals representatives from organizations. And these perceived benefits were consistent across time. So from the early 90s right up to 2016, there was quite consistent findings coming out. People talked a lot about the flexibility that individualized funding brought, that they were very much needs-led, that people could choose the type and timing of support that they received, and they could choose how the money was used, and that in reality, this led to a lot of benefits in their lives. So continuity of care, continuity in terms of the activities within their life that they were able to participate in. People talked about community integration and improved family life and social opportunities and a sense of improved self-image. So people talking about feeling less of a burden and focusing more on their abilities and what they brought to society. This is very much just touching on the perceived benefits, this is just to give you a sense. So in terms of the mechanisms that led to those successes, the network of support came up, I think, in almost every study that was out there. So really important to have a very strong network of support, whether that's organic or whether it's a paid network of support. The collaborative relationships were really important. So collaboration in terms of between individuals and providers, but also between agencies and departments. And what that did was it led to a shared understanding and shared learning as people moved through the process of what did work well and where there were challenges and how to overcome those challenges. And interpersonal relationships were really important. So this sense of building trust and, you know, bringing humor and flexibility into the work environment, because that's what's needed in reality on a day-to-day basis as you're leading your life, and not to be too constrained by processes and bureaucracy. Another mechanism of success was this financial recognition for voluntary work. So this was speaking to the fact that very often family members contribute an awful lot of time and resources towards supporting their loved ones, but this is not necessarily recognized financially. And this individualized funding for the first time for many people brought this financial recognition. And it meant that role was more valued. And again, it led to the person with the disability feeling less of a burden to their family member who was supporting them. And it also meant that they had more control over their life as to, you know, who it was that provided that support. Trust was really important as well, with very many people often recruiting people that they previously knew or that they'd built a trusting relationship with. So then in terms of facilitators from a staff or organizational perspective, having a local support organization was really important. So rather than having just a national oversight body, having local support organizations for the provision of information, guidance, advice, training around payroll, tax, paperwork for people who were managing it themselves. And then also having training available for, say, for example, staff recruitment and management or administrative skills, things that people wouldn't necessarily would have had to do in the past. And suddenly these were new tasks that they were being asked to do. So having that sort of training available, and then also having the availability of well-trained and informed professionals. I'm not sure how much time I have left, but I'm going to keep going until someone tells me to stop talking. So just to quickly look at some of the challenges. Again, it was split across a similar category, so perceived challenges and then perceptions of staff and organizational representatives. One of the things I would say is that there was a lot of cross-cutting themes. So for one person, what was a success might have been a challenge for another person. And I think that just points to the individualized nature of personal budgets and brokerage models. So for example, agency involvement for some people was seen as very negative based on previous experiences, but for others, it was seen as actually a really important and beneficial aspect. So for example, agencies were seen to lead to continuity of care or continuity of service. But in terms of challenges, and the things that people did talk about were agencies being inflexible or overly complex, that these often led to delays in the process, and that there were fears around people taking advantage of the funding or not using it appropriately, and that those fears weren't necessarily grounded in evidence and they weren't particularly helpful or beneficial. And the lack of available support within agencies was also challenging, along with other aspects such as a paternalistic approach. There were other potential areas or areas for improvement that we outlined in the review. So for example, inaccurate or inaccessible information or too much information or mixed messages. So the literature might say one thing, but the point of contact might be saying something slightly different. So people weren't entirely sure what was the correct process. So just clarity around that is really important when rolling these models out. Another potential problem was low pay for supports. So sometimes there was constraints put on how much you could pay for your support. So people might have wanted to pay more, but they weren't necessarily able to, and that led to some problems as well. I think I've touched on most of those there. Some potential problems from staff's perspective. So again, I mentioned there was fear. So fear around accountability, risk for the organization, a lack of control as to what's happening, and particularly around safeguarding. Organizations felt that they were responsible for individuals, but they couldn't put the necessary safeguards in place. So this was something that caused a lot of anxiety for those that were rolling out these supports. And as I mentioned, there was fear of abuse, both of individuals abusing the budget, but also that individuals were open to abuse because they were managing the funding. There was also some fears around the impact on existing services, so moving towards privatization, the poaching of staff from organizations to work for individuals on a one-to-one basis, fears around job losses or poor quality of care, and then also around practicalities. So just in terms of governance, calculation of allocations, assessments, all of these sorts of things. I would say that a lot of these fears weren't actually grounded in evidence, that a lot of it was based on anecdotal evidence, or people had heard of one scenario that had led to these fears. But from what we could see in the evidence, it wasn't systematically captured that these fears had actually been lived out. So that's a very quick overview of the findings from quite a large systematic review. But what I would say is, regardless of the intention of individualized funding or indeed the evidence base for it, it does seem that individualized funding continues to be adopted globally. So what we would hope is that this review provides a comprehensive resource of available data and evidence around the effectiveness of these various models, and also around the implementation successes and challenges in terms of informing and promoting progress in the area. Thank you very much for your time and for listening, and I'll hand you back now. Thank you.
Our next presenter will be Judith Gross, talking about multifaceted interventions for supporting community participation among adults with disabilities.
My name is Judith Gross, and I'm we did a systematic review, multifaceted interventions to improve community participation. And there we go. I'm the director of the Center on Community Living and Careers at the Indiana Institute on Disability and Community at Indiana University. We are our state's USED, our University Center on Excellence in Disabilities, and the Institute is. And our center, we have six centers at the Institute, and my center focuses specifically on areas of employment and community participation for people with disabilities. And we do a lot of work in transition to adulthood. So we train and support vocational rehabilitation counselors, community rehabilitation professionals, special educators, families, and young adults around the transition to adulthood, gaining employment and activities in the community for adult participation. The research I'm about to discuss was actually conducted while I was working at the University of Kansas, as was made evident in the last presentation. These systematic reviews can take a little bit of time to get done and published, and I think mine took about 3 to 4 years as well. The research, as I said, it was done when I worked at the University of Kansas, and I was working at the Research and Training Center on Promoting Interventions for Community Living at the time. This is what I'm going to talk about, our research topic and review purpose, partnerships for supporting the research, the results briefly, some implications, and challenges and benefits incurred during this process. So the research topic and review purpose. This topic was originally to determine the effectiveness of multifaceted interventions in promoting community participation outcomes for people with a disability. And it was a research project that was a part of a 5-year grant from the National Institutes on Disability, Independent Living, and Rehabilitation Research. So the research center had received this grant, and this literature review was the first step the first research project in that 5-year grant cycle. So at the time, this was, like I said, one of the deliverables. And at the time I began this work, the American Institutes on Research had a grant for the Net Knowledge Translation for Disability and Rehabilitation Research. And they had sent out an email talking about their ability to help promote the use of systematic meta-analyses and had basically inquired if folks were interested in their support. And so I checked in with our PI on the project and decided to inquire and check that out. And in doing so, we ended up with new partners on this project. So the PI agreed to modify the scope of the review to take advantage of the KTDRR support. Originally, the review was just going to be a narrative systematic review of the literature, but with this support, we were able to modify that to be a more rigorous systematic meta-analysis, and so that brought in some new partners as well. So at the Research and Training Center on Interventions for Community Living, that portion of this project was funding the university librarian as a partner in searching the databases and all of that, and helping to do some of the initial coding research, a research assistant, and the funding support that paid for my services there. And AIR, through their grant, helped fund a statistical consultant and a research assistant, and then provided technical support in the write-up process. So our research results, just real briefly, We found some effectiveness in studies in the following community participation outcomes. So in employment, we had mixed findings. We had one that was significant and one that was non-significant. Quality of life, same sort of outcomes as we looked at those individual outcomes. So when we look at community participation outcomes, I'm going to talk about this a little bit in the challenges, but one of the things that that came up, let me just back up a minute here to our purpose. So to determine the effectiveness of multifaceted interventions in promoting community participation outcomes for people with a disability. So one of the big challenges we had is just that purpose in and of itself, because multifaceted interventions is not well defined and not well studied. It's not a concept that is clearly defined out there. We had found one other systematic review that addressed the concept of multifaceted interventions, and the way they conceived multifaceted interventions wasn't how we were thinking of it when we began this research. And so simply defining what constituted a multifaceted intervention was a challenge. And then what constituted a community participation outcome? And then how do you define a person with a disability? And these things, we think they seem pretty simple as we do our protocols for our systematic reviews and we think we've clearly defined things. And then we dig into the literature and we find out we haven't even scratched the surface on those definitions. So when we're looking at community participation outcomes, we were identifying outcomes that were specific to activities that made the person be in and of the community. So things like employment and education and recreation and civic participation, like voting. But we also looked at kind of byproducts of community participation, things where there was already a literature base that connected community participation to a positive outcome of some sort. So things like quality of life, autonomy, social skills, self-determination, these types of things were what we considered to be secondary outcomes of community participation that we also looked at. And so, like I said, employment, quality of life, and adult learning and education yielded some positive results of the effectiveness of multifaceted interventions. Mental health, there were two studies of aging adults where the control group actually performed better. And then we found non-significant outcomes included in the topics of activities of daily living, autonomy, independent living, social skills, and just what we had generally defined as community activities. Again, if you want greater detail on these results, you can always go read the meta-analyses. A little bit, I would think what is most important about what we're going to talk about today is the benefits and the challenges in this process for me. I forgot I had an implication slide. Sorry. So some of the implications we found in our research was that there really was limited support, although there was some support for multifaceted interventions. So that suggested the need to do more research to determine the effectiveness of the concept of multifaceted interventions broadly, as well as specifically related to certain groups of people with disabilities or certain types of outcomes. Anecdotally, I noted that several of the studies that we looked at, when there were multifaceted interventions, they were often targeting populations where there was maybe a challenge with executive functioning. So the multifaceted intervention might be one that, for example, for someone who might have a traumatic brain injury, the multifaceted intervention might be something that is focusing on helping them with their organizational challenges or their time management or their self-control types of issues. And the other intervention piece might be an employment component, right? So it might be related to their work in the community. And so a lot of times those multifaceted interventions seem to combine in that way. When we defined multifaceted interventions, we really were looking at, we defined it as being two interventions within different domains, right? So if employment was our research topic area, our research outcome area, if both of the interventions were focused on their employment skills, building their employment skills, we did not consider that a multifaceted intervention. But let's say they had an intervention focused on building social skills and an intervention focused on access to transportation, and they were measuring their ability to get employed and stay employed if those things were in place. We considered that to be a multifaceted intervention, something where the intervention components were within two different domains of their life activities. So that made it very challenging, and that brought some challenges in how we looked at the literature. So knowledge, while we had this great partnership with AIR and supports in the statistical analysis and doing the research, the knowledge of disability varied greatly among our research team members. Myself being having a doctoral degree in areas of disability, I had a librarian who had limited disability knowledge except previous work she had done with our center. I had a young adult who he himself had a disability and I had hired as a research assistant through Project Search. I also had a research assistant through AIR with limited knowledge of disability and a statistical consultant with limited knowledge of disability. So I found that we've spent a lot of time really talking about what these terms meant, what did it mean to have a disability. And, you know, you think you've got that, and then you dip into the literature and you find that everything you think you've clearly defined is kind of being thrown out the window because of the way the world has defined these things. And we were dealing with articles where they were doing social security definitions of disability versus other more medical definitions of disability. And we really had to think about what the range of disability meant and which types of disabilities we needed to exclude from our research. And so we really narrowed our focus to target populations that were within the target group for our research center on promoting community interventions. So they had an identified, while it was a cross disability group, they had an identified target group, and we tried to limit the research to disabilities that would fall into the group that this organization would have typically served. And so that meant leaving out what were primarily medical diagnoses medical conditions of disability. So maybe someone had a stroke, and there was a whole article about interventions with stroke, people who'd experienced strokes, but there was no clarity in the description about how that impacted their daily functioning, right? There was no clear description of how that impacted disability. Things like diabetes or obesity or hoarding were listed as disabilities, and we had to really think about whether or not that fell into our definition of disability. And so that took a lot of time thinking about, you know, what constituted a community participation outcome and the interventions. We had a criteria that they had to be done in a community-based setting. Well, what did that actually mean when we said community-based setting? Did we count settings that were maybe in hospital-based settings where they had fabricated an environment to do their study? So it became complex, and we found that there was just a lot of the consensus building and the coding process was extremely iterative. And because of the complexity of these definitions and trying to really suss out what constituted community participation outcomes, what was multifaceted, we found that all decisions were made in partnership, right? So there was never one person who said, I'm excluding, you know, I did this review of like 500 articles and we're kicking them all out the door. Like, we literally discussed everything because the defining was just so complex. Other things that were challenging, my lack of statistical knowledge regarding meta-analyses made me uncomfortable. Clearly my issue, but it made it difficult for me because I never knew exactly what was being done. And I really had to trust my partners from AIR, and they were fabulous to work with. And then just the write-up, the manuscript process, the entire research process is really quite lengthy. Other things I just wanted to note benefits. While there were challenges to having such a diverse research team, there were also benefits. The very specialized knowledge meant that there were clear distribution of responsibilities and deep knowledge in those areas. We had a librarian who was very good at database searches, understood all the different terms and which ones you used where and why. And I never could have gone that deep into the databases. Other benefits, I also have new colleagues at AIR, and I wouldn't hesitate to reach out if I thought there was a question, a challenge, or a project on which we could work together. Another benefit, as I mentioned before, we did a more rigorous review. The original plan was to do a narrative systematic review. So the meta-analysis filled the research gap, and bonus was good for my CV. So thanks.
Let's move ahead now to our next group. This will be Katherine Dix and Petra Lietz from Adelaide, Australia, talking about interventions for anxiety in school-age children with autism spectrum disorder.
Well, thanks very much, Joanne and everyone. So yes, Katherine and I both work at the Australian Council for Educational Research. We do a lot of assessments about student performance. We also have a lot of professional resources to help teachers and school leaders. But this work falls under the research section, and it was actually we applied for funding from the Campbell Collaboration. Every now and again the collaboration puts out calls for suggestions for projects, and we responded to one of those, and we're very happy to receive this funding. So thank you very much again for that support. So yes, it was quite a big team that we had, there are also some researchers from other universities, but the main people working on it were from ACER. Just a quick overview what we're going to talk about. So a bit of the background in terms of the central concepts, why did we do this? Methodology, and then I'll hand over to Katherine for the results. And as we've heard, the questions, please, to the end. Thank you. Why did we look at what we looked at? obviously, ASD and that whole spectrum of disabilities has got quite large prevalence. So it's estimated that in the US, it's about 1 in 59 children, school age children. In Australia, about 1 in 150. And of those, it's estimated that about 40 to 50% have anxiety issues. Now, anxiety per se is nothing negative. Little bit of anxiety, like we all have also when doing these presentations, is good. However, if it interferes with the person's ability to function normally, then that's when it becomes a problem. And because more and more of children who have been diagnosed with ASD join mainstream schools, that's why we were interested in looking at interventions or at strategies that help those children to actually reduce the anxiety in real life context, we called it, so either at home or at school. So we excluded any purely pharmacological interventions, because we wanted to focus on things that could be done without drugs, basically. So where the intervention deals with, providing the children with strategies, calling on people to help them when they feel the anxiety coming up, or strategies like going and having some physical activity, or go back to a safe place or something, listen to some relaxing music. So we were looking at those sorts of strategies. Our actual review research question was, what is the relative effectiveness of interventions for managing anxiety of school-aged children with ASD that have been used in school, family, and clinical settings? We refer to clinical settings, but ultimately the intention of the intervention had to be to help these children at school or at home, so in their day-to-day life settings. Mm-hmm. So the study design, like with every good systematic reviews, and like the other presenters have also shared, part of what takes a long time is to actually go through, well, which criteria do we apply and how do we apply them for actually considering studies to be included in the review. So as we said, we wanted to focus on mainstream school-age children that had been diagnosed with ASD by a professional. And we're also experiencing anxiety symptoms, by a professional. The interventions, as I said, we excluded anything that was purely pharmacological had applied to real world settings. And the outcome that had to be measured, because that was the primary outcome for evaluating the effectiveness of the intervention, had to be anxiety. And again, it had to be measured by some instrument or diagnostic interview. And just to highlight here already that these studies, the outcomes could be either a self-report by the student or these checklists that teachers or parents or clinicians get to use. So those were the criteria for inclusion. And these were all the databases we searched. The Australian Council for Educational Research has, as part of the Cunningham Library, we are still in the lucky position to actually have, as part of our staff, trained and well-experienced librarians. So Jenny Trevitt did all the systematic searching, which is of course a real help in studies like this, because they are across all the thesauri of all these databases and can really give us good advice in terms of how to search. Search time frame was between 96 and 2018. And in addition to the databases, we also went to some grey literature sources. Now we followed the usual PRISMA methodology, where, as usual, you start with a lot of, not quite your, who started with 150,000, not quite. So we only started with about 3,500 and another 170 additional records. So removed duplicates, and then we screened titles and abstracts, excluded a couple of thousand based on that they either didn't have an intervention for managing anxiety, or there were some shortcomings in terms of either the measurement of ASD or the measurement of the anxiety. And we came across a lot of sort of books and guidelines rather than actual interventions. So we then ended up with 119 articles, for which we extracted the full text. And again, out of those, 95 were excluded. You can see the reasons for that there. As everyone who's ever done a systematic review knows, you can only give it your best shot based on the abstracts, but then often, they will be silent on whether or not or how they operationalize some of the central concepts. So anyway, as a result of that, we actually ended up with 24 studies, which we then included in the quantitative synthesis. And by the way, coming back to the first speaker, this was originally designed as a mixed method systematic review. However, based on feedback on the protocol, we decided that we would only stick to the quantitative aspect of the study. And even then, it was a lengthy process and certainly worthwhile, but with all the systematic reviews, a lot of, a long process, but good in terms of the robustness of results and the publication that comes out of it. Mm-hmm. Okay, so just in terms of the data analysis, we did an assessment of risk of bias in the included studies. Katherine will talk about that in the results. We, in terms of the measurement of treatment effects, in the overall analysis, because remember I said that there are three outcome groups that we considered, parents, teachers or clinicians and students. We gave in the overall results, we gave preference to clinician reports because we considered them to be more reliable than the other reports. In terms of units of analysis, with the non-standard designs where you have some crossover of groups, we only used the first measurement to avoid having them in there twice. In terms of the assessment of heterogeneity, we used the standard chi-square analysis, and because of the type of studies we had, we used the random effects meta-analysis. And Katherine, Judith, I think when you said you needed a specialist statistician, well, that was Katherine in our project. So she did all the hard yards with the actual analysis. And then the data synthesis approach, as I said, the three outcome groups plus overall. And then in addition to feedback that we got when we first submitted the results, we also then included a moderator analysis because some of the interventions involve family and others do not. And some of the interventions are focused on individual children and others do it in groups. Small groups, often only three children attending, but groups nevertheless. So we had a look at the differential effectiveness of those settings or situations. And then we also did some sensitivity analysis where we removed bigger studies to see whether effect of outliers or on the effectiveness estimates of the interventions. Mm-hmm. So then 24 studies were in the final results. We had a spread, so some in Australia, in the US, UK, and Singapore, Thailand, and the Netherlands, one each. Most studies had a randomized waitlist control design, and six of the studies were classified as quasi-experimental designs, so not as robust, but still meeting the criteria for inclusion. Participants, a total of nearly 1,000 across all the studies, and as a reflection of the prevalence of ASD, there are far more male students than female students, as I said before, school age, so 6 to 16, that was sometimes a little bit of an issue because the intervention actually went down to lower than that and higher than that age, but we tried to focus as much as possible on that age. Now, in terms of disability, there had to be a certain level of, while we didn't do a check for you know, some of these interventions do for IQ. There had to be a certain level of individuals' verbal IQ because, you know, in a lot of the studies required self-assessment, self-reporting of the students on their levels of anxiety. So they had to have a certain level of verbal functioning. Now, 22 of these studies that we found were a CBT intervention. The two that were not, one was a theater-based intervention, and the other one was a Thai massage intervention. So they were a little bit different. Outcome measures, as I said, they were different, but validated, previously validated outcome measures, mainly checklists. And now I think I'm going to hand over to Katherine.
Oh, there you go. So through the systematic review, as Petra sort of indicated, we have lots of different results, but we'll just show one as a sort of bit of an example today. Here's our lovely forest plot, and you can see this is the overall one. So it's got the 24 articles included, including the Child Front article at the top that had quite a high effect size. So you can see that overall we had a strong effect of 0.83 in favour of the treatment, and all but one of the studies was actually in favour of the treatment group. You can also see we've included the risk of bias down the right-hand side there, and that, for example, risk C, which is the performance bias, blinding of participants and personnel, which is quite standard in these types of studies where it's impossible to blind participants. They know whether they're involved in the treatment or not. So, that's sort of unescapable. But otherwise, we preferenced the clinicians' reports when it was in this overall snapshot, just to give a really clear insight as to what was going on. You can also see that the anxiety measures used in the studies. So the study coding there is the first four letters of the author, the year, and then another letter at the end that refers to the actual measures used. So you can see that, there was the scared, the PARS, the different types of measures that are quite standardised and well used internationally. So we were really strong on making sure that anxiety was appropriately assessed and also diagnosis of autism was appropriately assessed. And a lot of the studies did get thrown out because they didn't have that real strict measurement of and robust measure of anxiety. Some of the other things we looked at in terms of the groupings, moderator analysis. So we looked at, as you might remember, Petra said, we looked at interventions with families and compared them to interventions that just had the students by themselves, and the interventions with families had much stronger effect. So they had an effect size of 0.74 compared to 0.6 for students on their own. The groupings also had a quite different effect as well. So if students were involved on a one-to-one basis in the treatment, they had an effect size of 1.24, which is very large, compared to something quite small, which is only 0.37 for those group-based interventions. So there were differences there. And there are also differences in terms of the actual report, reporters themselves. Clinician reported outcomes in terms of the impact was even higher than what we've got here. It was 0.84. And this is with the outlier removed, and I'll talk about that in a second. The parent reported outcomes involved 19 studies, and they had an effect size of 0.53. And student reported outcomes that involved 17 studies had an outcome of 0.35. So you can see, you know, it went from quite high, strong outcomes down to moderate outcomes, getting down to quite low outcomes, which shows the breadth of variability just on the basis of user reporting, you know, the impact, which is something obviously to keep in mind. So the funnel plot, you can see that Chalifant is clearly an outlier. And so in those sensitivity analysis, we removed those. So those values that I was reporting was with those outliers removed. And summary of results. So basically, we found that the psychoeducational interventions for anxiety, which were predominantly cognitive-based therapies, were found to improve anxiety symptoms on average an effect size of 0.7 after that outlier was removed, having, you know, a positive impact on the mainstream school-aged children with autism. And we found that it was ultimately reducing the number of diagnoses of anxiety disorder for some of those participants. So that was a very positive outcome. Just to note again that most of the studies that were included were CBTs, and you know, the quality of the evidence was quite good, it was moderate. The effectiveness of interventions was generally stronger for clinicians, but reports were lower amongst parents and self-reported measures. So in conclusion, there is evidence that CBTs is an effective and behavioural treatment for anxieties in some children and youth with autism without co-occurring intellectual disabilities. The evidence for other psychoeducational interventions is more limited. It's not just due to the popularity of CBTs, but also due to the quality of the small number of non-CBT studies available.
And that's it from Australia. Thank you very much for your attention.
Ashrita, are you ready to go to talk about your evidence and gap map of studies assessing the effectiveness of interventions for people with disabilities in the low and middle income countries?
So hello and good evening to everyone. I'm gonna try and keep this short. So a bit about myself. So I'm currently affiliated with Campbell South Asia, which is the National Region Center for Campbell Collaboration. And it was established in the year 2019 in April and currently based in New Delhi, India. I would like to acknowledge the funding support provided for this map by Center of Excellence for Development, Impact and Learning, which was supported by UK aid from the UK government. And also the support from Disability Coordinating Group in terms of the guidance, a specific mention to Carlton Fong, who was the editor for this. And of course, I would like to acknowledge the contribution of our information specialist who helped us design the search strategy and also run the searches for us, as well as the epi reviewer team on which the app, this mapping utility is entirely based. In terms of the content expertise, it was provided by Dr. Hannah Cooper, who's the director of International Center for Evidence and Disability. So I will be very briefly taking you through some of these points in terms of what evidence and gap maps are and some approach and some key findings and implications. So evidence and gap map, they are a systematic presentation of the relevant available evidence for a particular sector and subsector. So typically evidence and gap map, they are in the form of a matrix of interventions and outcome. These are for the effectiveness evidence and gap maps. And the aim with which we develop evidence and gap map is to visualize what we know and what we do not know about in terms of graphical and interactive display of areas of strong, weak, or no evidence. So this is a snapshot of the disability evidence and gap map. Typically, the disability evidence and gap map provides an overview of the evidence that is available on interventions to improve well-being of people with disabilities, specifically in low and middle-income countries. This EGM included studies on all types of disabilities, that is hearing, intellectual, mental, physical, and visual. And like with all evidence and gap map, it's considered to be the first step towards developing an evidence architecture to inform policies, program, and of course, investment in strategies and, you know, better quality research. Like I mentioned before, evidence and gap maps, they are based in the form of a matrix. So for this evidence and gap map, the matrix was based on the community-based rehabilitation matrix, which is basically a multi-sectoral bottom-up strategy that operates at community level and is designed to meet the basic needs of people with disabilities. The reason for choosing a community-based rehabilitation matrix is obviously because it is widely known and is universally used, but also importantly because it advocates on the inclusive development for people with disabilities. And basically in the form of a twin track approach, wherein we are providing the needs of the people with disabilities in terms of reducing poverty, enabling access to health and education, but more importantly in trying to provide them right-based approach and, you know, reducing exclusion within the society and the community. So based on that, we developed our interventions and outcome main categories, which was entirely based on community-based matrix and included health, education, livelihood, social empowerment as their main categories. The subcategories to it were slightly modified based on the different strategic components that are described in each of these documents in each of these sectors, but was more or less largely based on this matrix itself. So this is basically the snapshot of the disability evidence and gap map. Like I mentioned, the rows of evidence and gap map, they are formed by interventions. The columns, they are described by outcomes. Importantly, the different bubbles that you see here corresponds both to the type and the quality of the evidence. And when you look at an evidence and gap map in an aggregate view, what you actually are looking at is basically the areas of evidence concentration, like I showed you and highlighted here in green. And what you're also looking at here is the areas of evident gaps. So the area of evident gap for this particular gap map and the area which is highlighted here is basically in the livelihood component. And the areas that I've highlighted for concentration is mostly concentrated in the areas of health. Also, as soon as you hover over the bubble on the interactive version of the map that is online, you're able to see the number of studies that corresponds to that cell or that intersection of interventions and outcome. And if you click on the bubbles, what you're also going to be able to see is to go to the read and the user summaries for those studies that have been created by the authors of that study. What you can also read here is the link to the main source of the study. Now, apart from the primary dimension of the map, which corresponds from the interventions and outcome, an evidence and gap map will also show you some secondary dimensions, which are called as the filters for that map. So for this particular map, we had different filters in the form of population, in the form of countries, in the form of region, which may be applied to the map to show only the evidence that is relevant to those filters. Now that was all about a brief, what exactly is disability evidence and gap map. Now where exactly did the motivation came from? As per the statistics by WHO, 15% of the world's population have some form of disability and 80% of them live in low and middle income countries. Not only that, the people with disabilities are largely excluded from the society in the form of employment, education, access to healthcare, and in terms of access to social participations. As per the World Bank's estimates in the year 2004, it was estimated that the global GDP loss due to disability can be somewhere around USD 1.7 trillion to 2.23 trillion annually for that year. Now, even though over the past decades, we have seen that there has been an increase in the academic literature on disability outcomes and the effectiveness, but what is still remaining and still unanswered, there are several important questions in terms of what type of evidence is needed, where exactly is the evident gaps, and what are the realistic expectations for disability inclusive interventions. So now, as we all know that the knowledge production or to influence policies and program takes place across several sectors. Like I showed you in the community-based rehabilitation matrix, it takes across health, education, and social welfare. At the same time, it focuses on various population, different ages and ethnicities, and of course with different needs. And it's gonna involve diverse methodological approaches in terms of systematic reviews, impact evaluations, different designs. So all of this is spread across the different platforms. And this is why we require a mapping of existing knowledge base is required to provide a comprehensive overview of existing knowledge in this area and to also make the evidence more discoverable, and also to identify where exactly the gaps exist and where exactly is the need to do research. With that motivation and with the support of funding from CEDL and UKAID, we started developing this evidence and gap map with some of the key eligibility criteria. There's a detailed description out there in the report, but of course the primary population that we wanted to include was people with disabilities living in low and middle-income countries. We also included subpopulation of parents, teachers, caregivers of people with disabilities, and of course some other subpopulation in the form of equity like gender and people living in low-income settings. The key study designs that we included were systematic reviews and the impact evaluation of intervention studies only. And we restricted our search to English language literature. One exclusion criteria was that is important to identify here is to, we did not include it specifically clinical trials or pharmacological medicines. So that was, those studies were excluded. Like with any systematic review, the systematic search is extremely systematic for evidence and gap map, of course. So it included, you know, searching the literature from academic database as well as the gray literature. We included studies from the year 2000 till December 2018, and it was done in two phases. The first phase involved, you know, searching the academic databases and international organization. The second search involved searching the additional websites that were identified through expert consultations. So of course, since we did not restricted our search in terms of outcomes and any other interventions, we were ended up with huge number of studies, of course. And after doing some data mining and duplicate removal, we screened some close to 9,600 records were reviewed. And in the end, we were left with 166 included studies that were relevant for our research question and the topic. Out of this, 59 were systematic reviews and 107 were impact evaluations. And close to half of these were identified to be randomized controlled trials. So this is an aggregate map indicating, you know, the areas of evidence concentration and the areas where we did not find much evidence. The one which you see in blue, that means there's an evidence concentration in this area. So of course, the most populated sector were health and the least populated areas were empowerment and livelihood. In terms of intervention design, again, like I mentioned earlier, the sectors that was dominated with evidence concentration was health sector, but even within this health sector, there were areas where we did not find much evidence, for example, in terms of mental health interventions. And the least dominated sector was empowerment and livelihood. In terms of type of impairment, we found very few studies that assess the hearing and visual impairment, and there was good amount of evidence in terms of physical impairment and mental impairment. In terms of outcome, it was similar to what we found in the interventions. There was limited evidence in the areas of employment and livelihood sector, and good amount of evidence in the areas of health and education. If I talk about the geographic spread of this, again, the studies were concentrated in only a few countries, with South Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa showing good amount of evidence. But even within those regions, they were concentrated within 8 low and middle income countries. So we identified 23 studies from India, 11 from China. So this is the spread, concentrated only in few countries. We also looked at if the studies were identified from fragile and conflict-affected regions. So we did identify 38 studies that concern fragile and conflict-affected states. What was important to note, we assessed the methodological conduct of these impact evaluation and systematic reviews. For systematic reviews, we used AMSTAR 2 checklist to assess the quality rating and the confidence rating. And for impact evaluation, we used approaches that was based on risk of bias assessment. So this tool was validated by experts, and we also pilot tested this tool to before applying it to the impact evaluations. So what we found is that there was key methodological limitations in impact evaluations conducted, though most of these were RCTs, like I mentioned before, half of these were RCTs, but there was clear, you know, methodological conduct issue over in the impact evaluations. And the similar picture was identified for systematic reviews, or there were, I mean, good amount of systematic reviews that had methodological limitations. So some of the key problems and challenges that we identified as a result of the findings of this map was that, of course, half of the impact evaluations and systematic reviews were on health. So we need more systematic reviews and impact evaluation on the other sectors. Studies were limited to only a few countries. So there are fewer studies from some of the key countries and key regions. So we need more evidence from those areas. There were clear methodological limitations, both in terms of impact evaluations as well as systematic reviews. And of course, we identified gaps in measuring interventions for vulnerable populations. By vulnerable population, I mean population people living from low-income countries or people from low-income families. And of course, gender-related issues, we identified that as well. So these were some of the evident gaps in terms of, you know, we did not find much evidence from livelihood intervention and impact of these livelihood interventions on empowerment and social related outcomes. This was a key gap that we identified. Evidence was also lacking in studies from educational outcomes related studies. There was absence of high confidence studies in the field overall. There were geographic gaps, like I mentioned, from low income countries and even from some of the major countries, or we did not find much. Limited studies were identified in terms of type of impairment, specifically from visual and hearing impairment related studies. And of course, like I mentioned, there were equity gaps in terms of studies, were very limited studies were identified from low income countries and and people belonging to low income minorities as well. Some of the key implications of the findings based on this map. This map can be used by research organization and the funders to identify the areas of evident gaps, like I showed you. So there's clear focus on the health model of the disability and not on the social model. This map can also be used for, you know, identify priority areas for investing in research. And as a result of this, there are three systematic reviews that are currently ongoing, because these were identified to be the evident gaps in the area. This evidence and gap map can of course be used to identify and invest in better quality research. Like I showed you before, consideration needs to be given to improve methodological conduct of systematic reviews in terms of reporting, as well as in terms of setting inclusion criteria or scope. And of course, there's a need to adhere to the standard guidelines set, such as PRISMA, for doing these kinds of studies. And of course, this EGM can be an important guide for the policies and program activities that can encourage more strategic and policy-oriented approach to setting future research agenda. In terms of next steps, I would like to mention that there are three systematic reviews underway, which are currently funded and supported by PANDA Initiative. And these are three topic areas on which this systematic reviews are underway. That is education, livelihood, and social inclusion. The title for this is already approved by Disability Coordinating Group and the protocol is underway. And we're also in the process of updating the map. So 2020 update is already done and we are currently working on writing the report and updating the map. And we hope to have this published with the revised report soon, maybe by end of this year.
I want to thank all our presenters today for sharing their experiences and the results of their synthesis activities. If you have any questions for these researchers, their contact information is included in the presentation slides, which you can download from the KTDRR website. We would very much appreciate your feedback today using the brief evaluation form. And please visit our website at www.ktdrr.org. We have quite a few resources online, such as the archive of past webcasts. To end today, I want to thank NYLR for their support for these webcasts and other activities of the Center on KTDRR. We look forward to seeing you at our next event. Thank you.